Welcome to the first appointment of the 2022 Torbricata Astrophysics Seminars. I am Mario Basilicata and I am a PhD student here in Torbricata, in the Torbricata University. Today, I am glad to present you the speaker of this first seminar, Gloria Gilwey. She got a master's degree in astrophysics at the University of Turin in 2017, where she continued her studies with a PhD, got in 2020. Since then, she is working as a postdoctoral researcher at the Turin, at the Astrophysics Observatory of Turin, and her main interests and research activities are related to the study of the exoplanetary atmospheres through the high resolution and low resolution transmission spectroscopy technique. In addition, she also studies the interaction of the exoplanets' atmospheres with the high-energy stellar radiation. She is involved in different international projects related to the study of the exoplanets like GAPS, SPICA, and ARIEL, and she is currently in visit at the Geneva Observatory. Today, she is going to talk about the exoplanetary atmospheres at high-resolution spectroscopy with Giano at the TNG. And so, Gloria, when you want, you can start, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Mario, for introducing me, and thank you very much to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present to you my work today. And as Mario said, today I'd like to talk to you about what I do. So the study of exoplanetary atmosphere at high resolution spectroscopy with Giano at TNG. And then I'd like also to speak a bit about what I did at low resolution spectroscopy. So today we have more than 4,000 confirmed exoplanets and more than 1,000 candidates and several methods that allows us to detect exoplanets. For example, here we can see as a function of the planetary mass and the orbital semi-major axis all the planets, all the exoplanets known today. While here we can see the cumulative number of detection as a function of the discovery here. Each color represents a different discovery method. And you can see that the main method adopted until now are the radial velocity and the transit method. And so I'd like to describe a bit these two methods that allowed us to detect so many exoplanets. Both these methods are two indirect methods. And indeed, we don't directly detect the exoplanet, but we see a variation in the star due to the fact that there is the exoplanet. So with the radial velocity method, we monitor the Doppler shift of the stellar lines due to the fact that the star is starting to rotate around the barycenter of the star plus planet systems. And by monitoring this Doppler shift variation, we can have an estimation of the period of the semi-major axis of the eccentricity of the orbit of the planet, but then we can also have an estimation of the minimum mass of the planet. And here I reported the first detection of a planet of this method, obtained by Mayer et al. In 1995, it was 51 peg B. The other method that I like to present to you is the transit method. A planet is called transiting if seen by Oort, it passes in front of the stellar disk. And this determines a decrease in the stellar flux received at Oort. And this decrease is proportional to the planetary radius. So bigger is the radius of the planet, bigger is the decrease in flux. And so by monitoring this decreasing flux as a function of the time, we can have an estimation of the planetary radius. And here I report the first detection of obtained by this method, that was the exoplanet HD209. So if both transiting and radial velocity method measurements are known for an exoplanet, we can put our planet on this diagram where we have the planetary radius and the mass. and we can determine the density. But for small size planet, the density alone is not enough to tell us how the planetary interior is made up of. Indeed, you can see from this diagram that several interior compositions are allowed to explain the interior composition of these small size planets. And a way to tackle these degeneracies is accessing the atmosphere of an exoplanet. Furthermore, studying the atmosphere of an exoplanet gives us also information about the individual description of the exoplanet, regarding, for example, the molecular composition, the presence of hazes and clouds, and also it gives us information about the TP profiles. Then, studying the atmosphere of an exoplanet can also allow us to put some constraint on the planet migration and formation. Indeed, if we derive some ratios, for example, the CO ratio or the metallicity, we can have information about these two mechanisms. And last but not least, we can also determine the surface conditions and so if a planet is habitable. And I'd like to focus a bit my attention on the sample on which I perform atmospheric characterization studies. This sample is made up of close-in odd Jupiters and dwarf Neptunes, so planets with a mass between 20 and 1,000 mass of Earth, a period less than 10 days, and a temperature greater than 600 Kelvin, and a radius between 4 and 20 Earth radii. Within this sample, we have both transiting, so as I told you before, planet that seen by Earth passes in front of the host star, or non-transiting planet, so planets that do not pass in front of the stellar disk. And there are several configurations that allows us to study the atmosphere of an exoplanet. For example, for a transiting planet, we can study its atmosphere when it's passing in front of its star in the transiting events. And in particular, we can study an atmospheric annulus, the terminator, so the part of the atmosphere that we have between the day side and the night side. And when the stellar light passes in this atmospheric limb, it gets imprinted of the molecules that are present in this terminator. And we create, in this way, it is created a transmission spectrum that is like an absorption spectrum. And we can see that in this transmission spectrum, each molecule absorbs at a given wavelength. So it's easy to understand which molecule we are dealing with. But transiting planets pass also behind the star. And so just after or just before the secondary eclipse events, we can study also the spectrum directly emitted from the day side of the planets. And indeed, we can do this by comparing the stellar plus planet flux that we have just after or just before the secondary eclipse with the flux that we receive when the planet is behind the star, so when we have only the star. By this comparison, we obtain the spectrum directly emitted from the planet. The spectrum directly emitted from the planet can be studied also for non-transiting planet, and in particular when these planets are at the superior conjunction. This means that they are at the maximum distance from the Earth. And in this particular configuration, at high resolution spectroscopy, we can also have some information about the true mass of the planet and also of the inclination, because since these are non-transiting planets, we can detect them only with the radial velocity technique, so we don't have information about the inclination, so the true mass of the planet. And so studying this atmosphere at high resolution spectroscopy gives us also this information. And exoplanet's atmosphere can be studied both from the ground and from the space. Usually, when we look at exoplanet atmosphere from the space, we talk about low resolution spectroscopy. For example, here we have a spectrum obtained at low resolution. We can see that the molecular detection are obtained by looking at broad molecular bands. But the problem is that, for example, when we have several molecular bands that overlap, it becomes difficult to understand which molecules we are dealing with. So more recently, a new technique has been introduced, so the techniques of the high-resolution spectroscopy. You can see that here, that each of these points becomes a spectrum full of lines, because each molecule at high-resolution spectroscopy is resolved in that dense form of individual lines, but also the high resolution spectroscopy on the inside has some disadvantages. For example, due to the fact that we observe from the ground, we have the contamination of our atmosphere, the telluric contamination. So it appears obvious that in the future, to have the best characterization of an atmosphere, we have to combine both low and high resolution spectroscopy observations. First of all, I'd like you start to describe my work at high resolution spectroscopy. So I'd like to summarize a bit the two main advantages of this technique. As I told you before, at high resolution, molecules are solved into a dense forest of individual lines. So we can understand which molecule we are dealing with through matching with between the observation and model template. On the other hand, at high resolution spectroscopy, we can separate the contamination of the HERT, so the telluric contamination, that is a stationary signal in wavelength. You can see from this image that the HERT signal is in black. It falls always in the same spectral channel. And we can separate it from the spectrum signal that is Doppler shifted, the white line, during the night of observation. And yes, I told you that I work at high resolution spectroscopy, but which is my instrument? The instrument is JANO. JANO is a high resolution spectrograph that is mounted on the Telescopio Nazionale Galileo a La Palma in Spain. And JANO is performant because it can combine at high resolving power of 50,000 with a wide spectral coverage between 0.92 to 2.45 micron. In 2016, JANO has been moved from the NASMIT A focus of the TNG to the NASMIT B focus, and it changed name from JANO A, now we call it JANO B, to say that now is mounted to the NASMIT B focus. And in this new configuration, JANO can operate together with ARS Nord, that is the visible arm of the Telescopio Nazionale Galileo, and together they can provide at high resolving power between 0.38 to 2.35 micron. Working in the JARPS observing mode, but they can still work separately. And with JANO, we can probe several layers of the atmosphere of an exoplanet, both the lower atmosphere and the upper atmosphere that is composed by the thermosphere and the exosphere. I'd like to start with the description of the lower atmosphere, and in particular, how we probe the lower atmosphere. We probe the lower atmosphere through molecular detections. And the technique that we use, I'd like to summarize the main steps. So first of all, we have to extract the JANO spectra from the raw images that we take with the spectrograph, and then our analysis is made up of three main steps. So first of all, we have to eliminate the contamination of our atmosphere that, as I told you before, are these black lines. And in the initial works we perform, we eliminated this contamination by using the relationship between the flux in each spectral channel and the air mass. So you can see that after the removal of the telluric lines, we remains with these matrix where each line is a residual spectrum at each wavelength, at each orbital phase. And here in the noise, we have buried, there is the signal, but is buried in the noise. So to maximize it, we can performing a cross-correlation between each of this line and a model template of the molecule we are looking for. And this is the cross-correlation function indeed between a JANO spectra and the model we are using. And we see that when the two model, the two spectra overlap each other, we have the peak of the cross-correlation. And then this is the final cross-correlation. So we have that each line is a cross-correlation function as a function of the radial velocity in the telluric rest frame and the orbital phase. In black here, we have the transit contact point, the ingress and the egress of the transit, while here is we have the planetary trail that is not very visible yet, so we can maximize the planetary signal by shifting all these cross correlation function in the planet rest frame by using this formula, where we have the radial velocity of the planet, the velocity of the observator respect to the solar, the barycenter of the solar system, and the systemic velocity of the planet plus star system. Then after the shifting in the rest frame of the planet, we can co-add all these cross-correlation functions. And we can do it for several KP values in order to monitor if there could be spurious signal in our final cross-correlation map. And this is our result. So we can see that we have the final cross-correlation in the planetary rest frame. And this represents the detection of water that we obtain in the atmosphere of HD219. It at rest in the planet rest frame and at the expected KP. And this map is the cross-correlation map in terms of significance, and the significance is calculated in this way. So we have the cross-correlation function in the planet rest frame. We compare the in-trail values, so the values near the planetary trail, with those out of trail. And from this comparison, we use the Welch t-test, with null hypothesis that these two samples have the same mean. And we compute the t-test and then the p-values of starting from this null hypothesis. And at the significance at which we reject this null hypothesis is the significance of our detection. So we first applied these techniques to this study. This is our first study obtained with JANO, so the atmospheric characterization of HD189, that is one of the most important and most studied of Jupiter. Before this study, exoplanet atmosphere at high resolution spectroscopy had been of domain of big telescope, of spectrograph mounted on big telescope, for example, CRIRES at the VLT or NIRSPEC at Keck. And so we asked to ourselves, it also small telescope equipped with performant facilities could be used to probe exoplanet atmosphere at high resolution spectroscopy. And the answer is yes. Indeed, we monitor HD189 for two transit events, and in one night we had several problems linked to the instrument, but in the other night we succeeded in detecting water with a significance of 5.5 sigma. This means that the TNG, even if it's a small class telescope because it has a diameter of 4 meters, can be used to probe exoplanet atmosphere at high resolution in the near with JANO. And so this is what we did regarding transmission spectroscopy with JANO A. And then we decided to do a step forward. And we asked to ourselves if JANO could be used also to probe emission spectroscopy. And so we analyzed the atmosphere of a giant planet, a hot giant planet, HD102. This is a non-transiting planet, so as I told you before, we don't have information about the inclination, about the true mass of the planet. We monitor this planet during three nights in March 2016, and this is the result that we obtain. So we detect water vapor and we detect methane. And this represents the first detection of methane obtained in the atmosphere of hot Jupiter, a close-in exoplanet at high resolution spectroscopy. And then it is also another success of JANO, because we demonstrated that we can probe also emission spectroscopy, we can study also emission spectroscopy with Chano. And then if we take the model with containing both water and methane, starting from the KP that maximize our detection, we can derive some information of the planetary true planetary mass. As I told you in the introduction, we can do this kind of things with the high-resolution spectroscopy, but then we can also give some estimation about the inclination of this planet. And as I told you before, at a certain point, John has been moved to the NASMIT-A, from the NASMIT-A focus to the NASMIT-B focus at the TNG, and now we call it JANU-B. With the advent of JANU-B, we changed a bit our analysis. So now the telluric lines are not removed anymore by using the formula I showed you before, but with the principal component analysis. And the idea behind this method is to find a set of trends that can describe all the varying signal inside our data, and so also the telluric lines. And then the cross-correlation analysis is performed as before, but on a set of selected orders. And this selection is made by asking at the same times to don't have spurious telluric residuals and to maximize the planetary signals. And this is the first big result that we obtained by using this new analysis. So the detection of six molecules in the atmosphere of HD209, that is one of the best studied at Jupiter known until now. And this is a big result because before this study, only two free molecules have been detected at the same times in the atmosphere of an extrasolar planet. While here, at the same times, we succeed in detecting six molecules, namely water, vapor, methane, ammonia, C2H2, ACN, and CO. We didn't detect CO2. This detection have been obtained by using isothermal model that from a physical chemical point of view don't mean a lot. So we also try to use other models and to change framework, to go from the cross-correlation framework to the likelihood framework by using this approach introduced by Brodje and Lai in 2019. So in the likelihood framework, now we can compare models by using the Wilks theorem. And so we use several models. So we use models in thermochemical equilibrium with clouds, models thermochemical equilibrium without clouds, and also model in disequilibrium. And by using the Wilks theorem, the likelihood seems to be maximized when we use a model in thermochemical equilibrium with clouds. So this should be the model that best fit the atmosphere of HD209. Then we use several models with several amounts of CO ratio, and we saw that our likelihood is maximized when we have a CO ratio that is greater than one. So probably HD209 formed far away and then migrated inward. And this is what we already published, but there are other works that we are doing. And in particular, I'd like to present to you this paper that we will submit soon. And that is the detection of five molecules in the atmosphere of another exoplanet. This planet is a bit warmer than HD209. And here we detected water, methane, ammonia, C2H2, CO. This is just to underline that not only in hot planets we can have such a rich chemistry, but also in warmer planets we can have a lot of molecules. And so this is all regarding what I did until now to characterize the lower atmosphere at high resolution spectroscopy. But as I told you before, we can also characterize the upper atmosphere, and in particular the exosphere and the thermosphere, through atomic detection. I'd like to introduce this concept starting from this diagram where we have the planets known today as a function of the radius and the incident stellar flux. Here we have the several families of exoplanets, Jupiter, Neptune, Earth-sized planets, and then here we have a gap. Here we have a desert. This is not an observative gap. This is a gap of exoplanets. Indeed, we don't have worm Neptunes because they disappeared. And one possible explanation of this desert is the atmospheric evaporation. Indeed, planets that are very close to their star are strongly irradiated, and so the atoms present in their atmosphere can expand and evaporate into space. For many years, the evaporation has been studied by using the hydrogen that is the most common element in the universe, and in particular, one transition of the hydrogen that is the Lyman alpha. But this transition is strongly affected by interstellar absorption and by geocoronal emission. And so more recently, a new diagnostic has been introduced, and this is in the NIR, so in the Giano wavelength range, and this is the helium, a particular transition of the helium atom at 1083 nanometers. And how we can study this diagnostic, how we can study expanded and evaporating atmosphere through the transmission spectroscopy technique. So here we can see that we have our planet with an extended atmosphere. Here we have the stellar helium line. When the planet passes in front of the star, we have an excess of absorption at the position of our helium line. And we can calculate this excess absorption by using the transmission spectroscopy technique, as I told you before, that consists of several steps. The main are the normalization of the spectra to the continuum, the correction for the telluric lines. We put ourselves in the telluric, in the stellar S frame, and we calculate this transmission spectral. So we take each spectrum and we divide it for the average out of transit spectrum. And then we shift the transmission spectra in the planet S frame. This is the first study that we performed with Giano, looking for an extended helium atmosphere. And it is the study of the atmosphere, of the extended helium atmosphere of HD189, where recently Salz et al. With Carmanes, that is another spectrograph in also in the NIR, I announced that there was this extended helium atmosphere. So we get rid several observations of this planet during 5 nights, and this is the final map that we obtain. So here each row is a transmission spectrum as a function of wavelength and the orbital phase. We can see here in blue that is there is this absorption feature, that is the helium absorption feature, that is at rest in the planet rest frame. Indeed, you see that is a bit straight in the planet rest frame, is not the same in the stellar rest frame. Then, if we average all the transmission spectra between the transit contact point T2 and T3, that are when the planet is completely in transit, we obtain this in transit transmission spectrum, and that has absorption of 0.75% at 25 sigma. And then we asked to ourselves how was the behavior of each night taken individually. So we perform some transit-like curve of these exoplanets, of this helium signal, and this is the results. So we see that three nights have the same behavior, but then we have two nights, the nights in black, that is the 5, and the night in red, that is the 3rd night, that do not exhibit the same behavior of the other nights. We asked to ourselves what was the possible cause for this variation, and probably is the star, because the star is very active, and so it can have some active and quiescent region that can mimic some absorption feature at the position of the helium lines. So to better investigate this point, we decide to also look at the H-alpha line, that is another diagnostic in the visible band, since this observation have been taken both with ARPS and JANO, we could also look at the H-alpha diagnostic. So we perform the transit light curve also for the H-alpha, and then we took the average between the transit contact point T23, both for helium and H-alpha, and we put the result on this diagram. Here we have the helium, and here we have the H-alpha absorption. We see that three nights have the same behavior. Then we have one night in which we have a pseudo absorption, a pseudo signal in emission, both in helium and in H-alpha, that is the black curves. And probably here the planet transited over a part of the stellar disk that was darker than the rest of the stellar disk, both in helium and in H-alpha. And so probably this region was a filament. While here we have extra absorption at the position of the helium channel and an emission at the position of the H-alpha channel. That means that probably the planet passes over a region that was darker than the rest of the stellar disk in H-alpha and brighter than the rest of the stellar disk in helium, so probably a quiescent region. And this is what we did for HD189. So we have this big helium signature, but we don't have only detection. Indeed, then we decide to look at WASP-ATB, that is a worm giant planet. It was expected to have an extended helium atmosphere because from the theory, it orbits a K-star, so we expected to have this extended helium atmosphere also from simulations, but we took three transit observations and we measured a flat transmission spectrum. We only succeed in putting an upper limit on this non-detection of 1.11 planetary radii. And so we tried then to use hydrodynamical aeronomy model to try to understand why we don't detect anything at the helium position, and the answer could be that if we assume a helium over hydrogen ratio that is 16 times smaller than the solar one and a stellar wind that is 25 weaker than the solar one, we can justify this non-detection of helium in the atmosphere of this extrasolar planet. So this is what I did until now at high resolution spectroscopy, but as I told you at the beginning, I also studied a bit of low resolution spectroscopy, and in particular by using the Wide Field Camera 3 of the Hubble Space Telescope. And I studied the atmosphere of these two planets that are HD106C and HD3167C, that are two small planets that have a size similar to the one of Neptune's. We have that small size planet have this particular distribution that is called bimodal distribution. So they have two peaks. On one side we have more rocky planet, and on the other side we have more volatile rich planets. And having a characterization of the atmosphere of this planet is very important, because as I told you at the beginning, the density alone is not enough to understand the composition of this small size planet. And so we decided to characterize the atmosphere of this planet. We took publicly available data and we analyzed them by using IRACLIS, that is a pipeline written by Angelos Searas. and we obtain the two transmission spectra of the two planets that I present here, and then we perform retrieval analysis by using the Taurex public code. So we simulated an isothermal TP profile, we put inside our retrieval these molecules, we put clouds, we allow the temperature to vary between -60 and +60% around the equilibrium temperature. We assume this range for the radius, and this is the result that we obtain. So for both the planet, we measure a significance atmosphere at 6 sigma for HD106 and a 5 sigma for HD316. We detect water in the atmosphere of HD106. And then we have the at 10^-2. This is the abundance that we obtain. And then we have also that the retrieval converged also for ammonia, even if this detection is not very significant. On the other side, if we go to HD316, we have a moderate detection both of water and of CO2. The presence of CO2 is unexpected for this kind of exoplanet because the temperature is low. So other molecules, for example CH4, should be in the atmosphere of this exoplanet. We can have CO2 only if you assume, for example, a high metallicity. So it appears obvious that other observation are important, both with the future Ariel or also other instruments from the ground, instrumentation from the grounds, to better understand if there is ammonia in HD106 and CO2 in the atmosphere of HD316, because the Wide Field Camera 3 of Hubble is very good for detecting water, but since it has a limited wavelength coverage between 1.1 and 1.7 micron, it is not very good for detecting other molecules. And so this is what I did for the low resolution spectroscopy analysis. And to conclude, I'd like to present to you a work that we did to try to put together both low and high resolution spectroscopy observation. Because as I told you, for the future, the best thing to do is putting together these two data sets. So we studied the atmosphere of HD209. These are the results that we obtain at high resolution spectroscopy that I've already presented to you before. And here I summarize the abundances that we obtain that maximize our cross-correlation, the significance in the cross-correlation framework. Then we analyze transit datasets at low resolution spectroscopy obtained with the Wide Field Camera 3 of the Hubble Space Telescope by using, as before, Heracles and Taurex. And we perform two different simulations, one with clouds and one without clouds. And according to the Bayesian evidence, the cloudy scenario seems to be strongly favorite. So this is in agreement with what we found at high resolution spectroscopy that I described to you before. But here we can only constrain the water molecule, not the others. And so then we asked to ourselves if in a future Ariel could allows us to detect all the molecules that we detected at high resolution spectroscopy. And so we perform two different simulations. On one side, we perform a simulation by using a model in thermochemical equilibrium with a CO ratio of 0.9 and a metallicity of 0 that is compatible with one of the models that maximize our likelihood at high resolution spectroscopy. And on the other side, we use abundances that maximize our cross-correlation analysis at high resolution spectroscopy. And we can see that the posterior distribution are not constrained if we have low abundances, both for Ariel, that is in in blue, and for the Hubble Space Telescope, the Wildfield Camera 3, that is in orange. But if we increase the abundances, so if we go to high molecular volume mixing ratio, we see that now we start to see something else. In particular, for low molecular abundances, we can only constrain water vapor. We don't constrain the CO abundances, and we can put only an upper limit on the abundances on the other molecules. While if we increase the abundances, we can see that from Ariel, we start to see an improvement compared to HST. So here we can see that we have an improvement from Ariel to HST, but if we have low abundances, we still need the high resolution observations to constrain our molecular abundances indeed. So it's obvious that in the future, both low and high resolution spectroscopy are complementary, and we have to know this. And I conclude by summarizing what I presented to you. So on one side, I presented to you the detection of atoms that allowed us to characterize the upper atmosphere of exoplanet by using the high-resolution spectroscopy technique from the ground. And on the other side, I presented to you the detection of molecules that can be obtained both from the ground, that at least in my work, that have been obtained both from the ground with JANO and both from the space with the Wildfield Camera 3 of the Hubble Space Telescope. And my future goal in my research would be try to do a helium survey, try to characterize more exoplanet that we can, and is a bit what I'm doing here in Geneva. I'm working on a set of 10 exoplanets, trying to characterize them. And then on the other side, concerning the molecules, is trying to do an atlas of all the molecules of several exoplanets, also to give some information, as we did for HD209, regarding the migration and the formation path. And that's all, and thank you for your attention.